Church, let's greet the Lord together. Psalm 108:3. We will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. We will sing of you among the peoples, for great is your love, higher than the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches the skies. Exalted, O God, above the heavens, and your glory will be all the earth. Amen. Lord, we just thank you for this day. This is the day the Lord has made, and your people rejoice, and we are all glad in it today. We thank you for being in our midst. We thank you that through the blood of Jesus Christ, we can all come into your presence this morning. We give you the glory and all the honor and praise. Amen. You guys can be seated. So thanks for coming out in this beautiful weather today. The elders just want to thank you for participating this morning. Any visitors this morning? No? All right. I'm sure you're all at home watching too as well. So our hope and prayer is that you're ministered to today, that his power and his presence and his provision. So we have any announcements, Mark, for you? Is that
loud? Please take a look at the back of your outline, and I want you to notice that there's a couple new ministries that we want to develop and maybe fold some of the older ministries into these new ministries. And they're going to be, we're going to have a meeting in February, on February 16th. And the first one is Enhance. And we want to get together and figure out how do we enhance what goes on in the church, the fellowship, especially how do we, from the moment we greet people to when they come into the ministries to how they interact with people here, how do we enhance that? So that's the first thing. So if you have ideas and if you want to be part of this, and then I want you to come and we'll set up a team and I will give you some direction. And then the other one is Engage. How do we effectively engage the community with our vision, with the life of Christ, and with our message? What are some creative ways in which we can begin to engage the community? And so those will be two ministries, and they're just going to be in a startup form, and so we want to talk that through and see who might want to be involved. And like I said, some of the other ministries, we might just fold right into that, because we really want this to be effective. And I know there's some people have some great ideas, and they've already talked to me about them. Now, as an incentive, that night, I'm going to be making my award-winning Sicilian chili for anyone who comes. Now, I won two awards, one here and one at the Vets. We had a big, giant contest, 22 different chilies, and mine won. Can you imagine that? All right. So, it was a major award. So I'll just tell you that. So, we're going to be doing that on February 16th, which is a Sunday night. We'll be meeting at 6:30. So, if you're interested, and there are some people that are already involved in these because we talked about them, so please do keep that in mind. Please know that the annual congregational meeting is coming up on the 24th. So, please come to that so we can figure out where we're going in the next year. Okay? So, yes. Oh, I'm sorry. It should be Sunday night, so yeah, the 17th. I'll correct that. Unless you want it on Saturday night, what would be better, Saturday night or Sunday night? For most people, what's better, Saturday night or Sunday night? Sunday? Okay, we'll do it then. All right, let's pray together. And we want to, again, always proclaim the Lord's Prayer and how graciously He is to us as our Father. So let's worship with this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And Heavenly Father, we simply proclaim that yours is the kingdom, that you are the king, and that we are in the midst of your kingdom right now. Even in this moment, in this place, in this time, we are part of a kingdom. And Father, we pray that you would help us to see your kingdom, to receive it as a gift like little children, that we would perceive its effect in us, and we would be able to advance it. Lord, we ask this morning that in this coming season, this year that is still so new, that we and each of us here would advance the kingdom in a new way. And Father, we thank you that you also have all the power in the universe, that there is nothing that is more powerful than you, and you demonstrated that power when you raised the Lord Jesus Christ from the dead and seated him in the heavenly realms on a throne. And God, we know that that same power works in us. And Lord, it's not that we feel it, it's not that we even understand it, but Lord, I ask that there would be a release of your power, that resurrection and ascension power in our lives in this coming season. Those things that we struggle with, those things that we are excited about achieving, the visions that you give us, that all of those things would be done by your power. And Lord, we know that your power is made perfect in our weakness, and that is a conundrum of this Christian life, Father. Oftentimes, you cause us to be powerful, and we don't even know it, but the result is that you have all the glory, and that's what we pray to, Lord. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, and we pray that we would be a church and we would be individuals who bring glory to your name so that you are exalted and that you would be glorified in us. Father, we pray for this country, that you would continue to watch out for it and protect it, and that you bring healing, that you'd pour out your spirit, and that there'd be revival. And Lord, we thank you that you provide all of our needs according to your riches and glory. We pray that you'd continue to provide for our needs, provide the finances that we need to make the last payment to our builder. Lord, we know that you're the God that does miracles, and so we simply pray that you'd show us your provision. And Lord, we are here this morning to worship you by giving our tithes and our offerings. And we come before you and we know that this is what sets us apart in so many ways, when we are willing to trust you with our finances. So Lord, we just want to proclaim what Scripture says. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And Father, we pray that indeed that you would cause us to be cheerful givers through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So please come forward and give your tithes and offerings, and then after you do that, greet one another. You could probably greet everyone today because there's not many people here. So bless you.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Faithfulness too, in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He is more awesome than all who surround him. O Lord, God Almighty, who is like you? You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you.
To God,
to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Saints cry out, we join you as we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever.
Thank you. all the thieves will come confess. Know that you are holy. Know that you are holy. And all will sing.
Yeah. Holy Lord on high, majesty surround your throne, cherubim and seraphim bow down. Lamb who died and lived, faithfulness surrounds your throne, cherubim and seraphim.
Come right here. We want to worship a little together. Just come up front. Get close. We want to sing to the Lord, so get close and close your eyes and let the Holy Spirit sing something through you. Sing with me.
Holy Lord, we give you glory. There is none like you. Holy Lord, we give you glory. There is none like you. Holy Lord, we give you glory. There is none like you.
Sing to your King.
We love you, Lord. We give you glory. There is no one like you. You are the God of God and the King of Kings. No one is like you. Exalted in your holiness, majestic.
Sing what's on your heart. From your throne, your throne. Glory
is.
If there's anyone that has something the Lord has put on your heart while we were worshiping, just come and speak it.
Pastor, if I could have you just come down here, Pastor. Come down here. I want everybody, let's just surround Pastor. Everybody just reach out, grab somebody else's arm. Let's just protect him. Everybody grab somebody. Dear Lord, as I sat here worshiping, I looked out at the cross on the window and I saw the wind and the storm and the snow, and I just prayed. I said, I wish everybody would just come forward so we could pray over Pastor. And you did that. Everybody is so worried about the storm on the outside, but we just don't understand that we have a great protection on the inside. We have this amazing spirit that God has put in us to overcome any storm in our lives. And when we focus on the inner, not the outer, we can truly experience His love, His healing, His grace, and His mercy. And Lord God, I just ask that You protect each one of us. Make each one of us like You. Make each one of us understand the love that You give for us, the protection and the provisions. And Lord, I just ask and pray now over Pastor that You just heal his body, continue to make him strong. Lord, he has a sermon and a word today that's going to set fire through this church, through the people that are watching at home. And Lord God, we just know that You're the God of God and the Lord's of Lords, and You are with us to get it done. And we just pray over this church, over this congregation, that we would continue to progress. It's not about perfection, Your perfection. For us, it's about progress. And Lord, we just thank You in this day, and we give You glory and praise and honor. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. We're going to keep the children in today, mostly because their teacher is not here and the material is not here, but I think it would be good for them to stay. You know, I don't think there is anything more sacred than you can do in worship than to sing what's in your heart toward the Lord. And I know for some of us that's hard because we aren't used to just singing whatever's in our hearts. But I think that, believe it or not, that there's something in us that is natural to us, but we've been taught not to do it. And I was watching my little son Nico the other day, and everywhere he went, he hummed. And he has a habit of doing that. He walks around and just hums a tune. And I was thinking, you know, it's that inbred thing. You know, no, Emily hasn't taught him how to sing. I mean, but Nina sings a lot too, and he just picks that up. And I think I want to encourage you, when the worship team allows for time like this, the Holy Spirit, one of the ways you experience the gifts of the Holy Spirit is to allow Him to work in your life and for you to step out in faith. And this is an easy way to do it, is to allow yourself to sing those things that He will put on your heart. And those things are, they're your words, but He gives you the thoughts. And we try to make the melody clear so you can follow the melody. And you know, if you can do that, great. If not, you'll learn how to do that. You'll learn how to do that. But I would encourage you. I think that when you do that, it's like Mary pouring oil on the Lord. I really do. That when you allow yourself to just sing to Him, because there's a bit of humility, isn't there? There's a bit of not being prideful. And what I mean by that is, what are people going to think, or what if I say the wrong words? All of that stuff the Lord didn't care about. And Mary got some criticism for what she did, didn't she? And I'm sure that there was a sense in which she was embarrassed in front of all of those disciples when she was criticized. Or she could have been, but she wasn't. Because there was something, she chose the one thing. The one thing. Well, we want to... I'm going to share with you this morning something I hadn't planned on sharing, but before we do that, let's stand for the reading of Scripture.
Psalm 62. For God alone my soul waits in silence. From Him comes my salvation. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall never be shaken. For God alone my soul waits in silence, for hope is from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rest my deliverance and my honor. My mighty rock, my refuge is in God. Trust in Him at all times. O people, pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. There are times in our lives when we just will suffer loss. And that loss sometimes can be incalculable. You know, the death of a child, the death of a husband or a wife, or a death of a loved one that's important to you. There are other losses that you may be in the midst of or may have experienced. And the thing I know about life, it's about loss. Because all of us eventually will lose our lives. And so that loss is built in. And loss is never something that we take well, I don't think, most of us. When we experience loss, it's something that it grips our hearts, it confuses our minds, and it's difficult. And chapter 25 of 1 Samuel is, I think, one of the most important chapters in the life of David. You know that by just the amount of verses that are there, the amount of space that the Holy Spirit gives to this chapter. And the thing is that there's only one chapter that has more information than this one in 1 Samuel. Which one do you think it is, knowing David? What was one of the biggest events in his whole life? Yes, very good, Peter. Peter. Goliath. The only chapter in all of 1 Samuel that the Holy Spirit gives more information to is his battle with Goliath in chapter 17. But this chapter ranks a very close second, and it's because some profound things happen in David's life. There's great loss, but then there comes great blessing. And I was originally going to preach two sermons on this, and I got to verse 1. And I just couldn't leave it this morning. And I felt like the Lord said, just stay right here because someone needs to hear this. And next week we're going to look in the next 2 weeks at the profound effect that Abigail had on David's life. And it is profound. And she was like the angel of the Lord's presence to him. But this morning I want to look at this one verse, verse 1. Let me read it to you. Now Samuel died, and all Israel assembled and mourned for him. And they buried him at his home in Ramah. Then David moved down to the desert of Maon. Well, let me pray for us. And now, Father, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts would be pleasing in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It struck me that this first verse is so profound, and it only makes three statements. The first one is just that statement, this, now Samuel died. And all Israel mourned him. There was no one other than maybe Jonathan. There were three people that were significant in David's life for his spiritual direction. But the first one really was Samuel. Samuel was not only the prophet that anointed him, but when David had to run away and he was at his worst, he went to Samuel, and when he stayed with Samuel, And King Saul tried to kill him 4 times. The power of God came on everyone that even the king, even King Saul, everyone that Saul said, and even the king, the power of God came on them and wouldn't allow them to touch David. And the influence throughout his life that Samuel had on David was profound. And you can imagine, when David is in the midst of this terrible ordeal and what it means for him to become king, in which he's always running and hiding, and yet he's getting to know God, but there's never a sense that he's safe from what's going on. And you can tell by his Psalms that David is often pretty bummed out about all this, right? Can you get from his Psalms that he struggled and that he went through difficult times and he really, it gripped him, hiding in caves? And yet there's this sense about David that we see in this passage that shows you why he's the man after the heart of God. And there was a period of mourning, and David mourned with them. That's indicated in the verse, in the language, that he was included in this. And I can't imagine the mourning that David has gone through. I remember when I've lost a couple really close friends. One of them was the man who I mentored him in the Lord, and he mentored me in photography, an amazing man. He died a couple years ago. And when he died, he was just about to come out here and spend time with me, and he died before he could make it. It just struck me. I mourned for the longest time because, you know, he was just really close, and there's been a couple other people that have died, and you know what it's like to mourn, don't you? When you've lost a loved one, it just grips you in your heart, your mind, all the memories come flooding back, all the places that you went together, all the things you did, these things, and they only become good memories after a while. Because some people say, well, you know, remember what you had. But you can't remember what you had until you mourn for what you lost. And so mourning is a process that you have to go through. And so some of you may be mourning about the loss of something and the breakup of a marriage, the difficulties with children. There's lots of losses that we can go through, aren't there? And they grab us and we wonder, God, where are you? And what made David the man he was? And the thing that strikes me about this is that the day of trouble will always come. David writes about this, and he says, listen, one thing I ask of the Lord. This is the one thing I ask, and this is what I'm going to see. God, when it comes down to this, I just want this one thing. And the one thing is made up of three things. The one thing I ask of the Lord is this is that I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Now, as you know, that the house of the Lord wasn't built yet, and even the tent, the ark, probably wasn't even there at this time. When David talks about the house of the Lord, he uses it in a spiritual sense. He uses it as a place where you could meet with God, his sacred place where he would meet with God. At some of his worst times, when he's out in the wilderness, he says, behold, I've seen you in the tabernacle. Well, he wasn't in the tabernacle. It wasn't anywhere near him. And so the idea here is David says, listen, this one thing, the first thing is this. Listen, I want to dwell in your presence. I really want to experience your presence. You know, and when I ever spend time with people and they say, Mark, what is the secret of the Christian life? I says, here it is, this one thing that's made up of three parts. First, you have to desire the presence of God more than anything. You have to have that sense in which, Lord, I just want to dwell with you. You know, Jesus wrote a whole chapter on that, which is what? He doesn't use the word dwell, but it's the same word. If you dwell with me and, abide. Chapter 15 of John. If you abide in me, it's that dwell, that sense of being in the presence of God. And the next thing David says is this. One thing I ask of the Lord, and this is why I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord. And the idea is that is to see the attributes of God. The beauty of God is really his attributes. What makes God up? Well, he's faithful, he's loving, he's powerful, he's sovereign. You know, he has authority. You know, he's trustworthy. He forgives. I mean, the attributes of God are manifold. And it's like, wait a minute, God, do I really behold your attributes? Do I really behold your beauty? Am I able to say, I know your faithfulness? I know it. When I'm in the worst possible circumstance, can I say, I know you're faithful? I've seen your beauty. I know you're faithful. You see, when I was in the military and when I was in basic training, you know, it's a difficult time. You know, it's very unusual basic training, and I did this too. All the guys, what did they keep in the pocket uniform? Picture of their girlfriend. And at night, they'd take it out and they'd look at it because they wanted to remember the beauty of their girlfriend. You see, that's how this verse is really that at that level of intimacy. You know, God, I want to behold your beauty. I want to know that your love is real. You know, I want to know that, yeah, you are faithful. I want to behold it. That means I want that to experience in my life. And then the last thing he says this, to seek you in the temple. Now the idea is this, and there are three temples, right? The first one is the temple in heaven. You know, it's real, it's there. Revelation 4 and 5 says this. You know, God wants you to experience the supernatural. Paul tells us this, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. And a lot of people stop right there. And it gives you that impression, well, we just can't figure this all out.
But then God says, but God has revealed it to us by His Spirit. You mean what God has prepared that you can't figure out by looking, you can't figure out by listening, you can't figure out by hearing, the Spirit of God will reveal. Because it goes on to say that the Spirit searches all things, even the depths of God. Wow. That we, by the very nature that the Spirit of God dwells in us, we can know the deep things of God. What's the deepest thing on the heart of God? God will show you that. What is it? And do we want that one thing? God, I want to see that temple, but the other temple is here. You know, here's the temple. He's the temple of the living God. Don't you want to see God in that temple? Don't you want to see Him show up in you? God, be glorified in me. You know, when I was going in and out of, you know, when you come out of surgery, you go in and out, and then there's two things that the Lord kept saying to me in my conversation. One of them was very personal, but another one was, I kept saying to the Lord, glorify your name. And He said, I have glorified it and I will. You know where that's from. And that kept coming to me. You know, and isn't that the desire of your heart? That you would glorify the name of God, and that in you, in your temple, God would show up. And then the third temple is the church right here, you. And we have a nice exterior now, and I love it. I just love it. It helps worship, and it's just beautiful. But you make it a temple by being here. You know, you make it a temple. And even if when I'm here by myself, it's still a temple because I'm here. But the point is this, is that you want to see Him in the temple. Do you see the Lord in each other? Do you look for the Lord in each other? You know, we are really good at being critical. I mean, I can criticize anyone. You know, I can find something bad with them if I tried. Now, that's not my nature. But if I tried, I could. But you see, anyone can judge, but can you save? And so you want to, do you see the presence of the Lord in each other? Look for it. Look for it. And David says, this is why, because in the day of trouble, you will set me high upon a rock and you will shelter me in your tabernacle and in your dwelling. You know, in that place, in the dwelling place of God is where God protects you. There's no other protection. The church, the early church, the only church there was, the Catholic Church at one time understood this and how they applied it. Everyone knew. And even governments obeyed this. It's strange. You know, the church was the sanctuary. If someone fled to the church and said sanctuary, the king, even the king would not go in there. Why? Because he respected it was a sanctuary. You see, the principalities and powers cannot come against the temple if you dwell there. Can't. There's no authority. No authority in this place. The thing about David is that he went, there was this loss and there was this mourning, but the thing I want you to see, this, then, in response to all this, there was the movement. Then David moved down into the desert of Maon. Isn't that amazing? David's mourning, his mentor, one of the most powerful prophets that ever existed, and you know his story. When I wrote the curriculum for the little kids, we looked at the life of Samuel, okay, as a little boy, and what happened. You know how powerful he was. He heard from God, and he was so devoted to God. That's how David learned to be devoted to God, too, is through Samuel. His mentor, the one who protected him, dies, and David mourns and mourns. And he's in this terrible situation, like, I'm sure he expected, wait, you're the guy that anointed me king. You're not even going to be around to see me become king. It had to be an incalculable loss for David. But you can tell the man David was by what he does next. He goes into the desert. He goes into the desert. You see, he's just like the son of David. You know what I mean? God looks at David and said, you're a man after the heart of God. And listen, David was like Jesus, not in his sinfulness, but in who he was as a worshiper and in his relationship with God. It was the same as Jesus. Go ahead a couple, few centuries. Here's Jesus. John the Baptist is his cousin. Is the one who baptizes him, the one he exchanges conversation with, the one who introduces him to Israel, the one who was so humble that said, listen, here's the one that's to baptize you with the Spirit. I'm not even worthy. And Jesus says about John, there was no one born from woman, which means everybody, okay? Because there's no one here that wasn't born from a woman, okay? It's impossible. No one born from woman is greater than John. And then what happens to John? Terrible end to John. Evil woman asks for his head and he's killed. And when Jesus heard this, what does he do? He gets in a boat and he goes to a solitary place to be alone with God, just like David. Yeah, you know. You see, the heart of David was, no matter what happened, no matter what went on, no matter what loss it was, no, he just said, I'm going to get alone with God. That's my only solution. I got to get along with God. I got to go out and just spend some time. And you know, it was the place he went, it was the place Jesus went, it was the desert. And from the beginning, the desert was a place in Exodus. You know, God says to Moses, go tell Pharaoh to let my people go so they can come out in the desert to worship me. You see, the desert was always going to be, the desert was going to always be that place where the people of God went to seek him, where the people of God went to worship him. And so here David has the worst loss in his life, you know, an incalculable loss. And he's in the middle of a difficult situation. And the heart of David, and you know, when we suffer loss, we can do all kinds of things to make ourselves get better. We can get into distractions and, you know, some people, when they suffer loss, they turn to lots of things that never help. You know, they'll blitz out on something, or they'll start to drink more, or all of those things that never help. And what set David apart was, listen, when he suffered loss, he said, I'm going out into the desert. Not on a horse with no name, but he went out into the desert, okay? And he wanted more than anything to just know God. Now listen to what one of the psalms that he says from the desert, and I love this. It's not when he went out into this desert. I think it's when he went out into the desert of Judah, but it gives you an idea of what's going on in his heart. Listen to my prayer, O God. Do not ignore my plea. Hear me and answer me. It's that God, I need to make contact. I just really need to engage you, God. You got to be there. You got to hear me and answer me. I'm struggling now. I've suffered a terrible loss and I'm struggling. And then he says, my thoughts trouble me and I am distraught at the voice of the enemy, at the stares of the wicked, for they bring down suffering upon me and revile me in their anger. And I do not believe, because in most of those places, I don't even know if there were real people around. The voice of the enemy certainly is involved here. The voice of the enemy, when you go through loss, when you go through suffering, the voice of the enemy is going to come and do this, just the same thing. And it's going to make you troubled and distraught, and he's going to bring down suffering upon you and revile you in his anger. That's a terrible thing. But listen, the enemy loves to say, see what you did. Look what happened to you. It's never going to get any better. You're never going to get out of this. God can't help you. Things aren't going to improve. This loss, you're never going to make up, you know. And one of the things that God keeps saying to me, and I don't know why, but he said, Mark, everything I've ever taken from you, I've given back, and it's better. He must have said that to me 5 or 6 times in little things. Like, all of a sudden, I'd find something I'd lost, and I'd go, wow, and then I'd hear that, Mark, everything I've taken from you, I've given back to you, and it's been better. So I thought, wow, Lord, that's true. That's really true. So I'm going to do what David did. And see, the enemy loves to revile you, to revile you. And then look what he says. My heart is in anguish within me. The terrors of death assail me. Man, this is terrible. I feel like I want to die. This feels so bad. I feel like I want to die, you know? My heart is in anguish. What a word. That word means to almost like your heart is being crushed to death. Fear and trembling have beset me, and horror has overwhelmed me. Wow. Have you ever been there? Where because of what you've lost, because of what you've been through, your heart is in anguish, you feel the terror of death, you're horrified and overwhelmed. Well, you're not alone. And then this is how he responds to all that. Isn't this, this is beautiful, look at this. I said, oh, that I had the wings of a dove, I would fly away and be at rest. I would flee far away and stay in the desert. Selah. Think about that for a minute. David said, this is how I can solve this. I'm going to the desert. I'm going into the desert. I'm leaving. I'm going to fly away from all this. You know, because David uses poetic language, but he actually does this because he was in the desert when he wrote this. So he's explaining his experience. He wasn't in the desert. Something was going on. He said, I'm leaving for the desert. And he actually went there because we know that he wrote this from the desert of Judah. And I love this. I would flee far away and stay in the desert. I would hurry to the place of my shelter, far from the tempest. In the storm, in the book of Revelation, which we're going to get to, you see the dragon come after the woman, and he wants to kill, you know, the Lord Jesus Christ, and God snatches him and brings him up to the throne, and the woman runs where? To be protected, the desert. Look it up, Revelation 12, the desert. Very symbolic, but it means, you know, the book of Revelation. A lot of people don't get this, but the very thing it starts out, if you look at the Greek, it says, these things that I'm going to say are symbols, are symbols. God revealed symbols. And so a lot of people don't get it, and they miss it, and they try to make symbols real. No, symbols are symbols. They stand for something that will be real, but I digress. We'll get into this. But what I want you to see, the place of the desert from Exodus to Revelation was the place that God brought his people out to when they were hurting, when they were attacked, when they had suffered loss. What does it mean for you in the midst of whatever you're going on, saying, I want that one thing. The only thing I'm going to turn to in this, Lord, I'm not going to turn to my friends. I'm not going to turn to activities. I'm not going to turn from things that might lessen my pain. I'm going out to the desert. A desert was a place of desolation. It was a place of wildness. It was a place of wildness and dryness that God said, come out here because you won't be distracted. And the thing about God, and we saw this a couple weeks ago, and Robbie preached on it, and I talked about it a little bit, and we went over it on Wednesday night in the Bible study in Isaiah 43:18. God says this about the desert. The new thing he's going to do, he says, I'm going to make a way in the desert and streams in the wilderness. The point is, when you go out there into the desert and you trust God and say, God, I this has been terrible. I've suffered this loss and I'm struggling and I'm in anguish and I'm horrified and I just don't feel like I'm going to make it. Go into the desert. Because when you make the choice to do that, to get alone with God and to seek him in his word and to pray and maybe go away for a weekend and just stand alone with God or start every day getting up early and saying, God, I'm just going to get with you. God does two things. In the desert of that place, he gives you direction, right? He makes a way and he gives you refreshment. He causes streams. Isn't that great? Streams in the desert. We talked about it. There's a great devotional, one of the old ones, you know, pretty old. I'm fairly old, and I started to read it when I was a young Christian, so it's been around for at least 50 years, and it's called Streams in the Desert. You see, when I make that choice to get out in the desert with God, God gives me direction. This is what you need to do now. Direction's pretty simple. Mark, do this. This is how you can handle this. And refreshment. All that terror. Horror, all that thing, God just refreshes me. And my place of shelter, far from the tempest and the storm. And the last thing I want you to see, and just I want to share with you, is the idea that God, this is what God does in the desert, I really believe. Psalm 63, we read it before, for the reading, but I want to read it again. For God alone my soul waits in silence. From him comes my salvation. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall never be shaken. For God alone my soul waits in silence. For my hope is from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my deliverance and my honor. My mighty rock, my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts before him. God is a refuge for us. And God, isn't that beautiful? Because out in the desert, it's the place where you come to that point and you say, God alone. God uses people. He used Samuel. We're going to see him use someone else in David's life very powerfully. But we can't appreciate people until we certainly appreciate God first. Until we make God alone in our lives, people will never fill our lives the way God wants them to, and they'll never really meet our needs because we're trying to put them in a place that only God wants. But if you make God alone, then we can relate to people and they can have good places in our lives and God will use them like he did with Samuel and like he will do with Abigail. But what I want you to see is, first of all, when you get alone with God, there's some things you need to do. Be silent. There's a time to talk. There's a time to listen. All right, God, I just want to be silent. You know, how hard is it to just be silent before the Lord? Just say, Lord, I want to get before you now. I've prayed out everything. You know how I feel. I've been praying this for weeks, the same prayer. Let me just listen. And just be quiet until you feel, you sense the Holy Spirit is starting to speak. It's hard to do that, isn't it? Well, let me look at my phone first. Don't do it. Leave your phone at home. Well, you know, there's a verse on my, no, take your Bible. Be silent. Silent until you feel the voice of the Lord speaking to you. Till you sense in your mind and your spirit that I think that's his voice. Just be silent. In the silence, you have to just, all the thoughts that come in say, no, no, Lord, no. No, I just want to know you. Until your mind just kind of, you know, it's kind of like, you know, in the morning when you get up and your windshield has all that stuff on it, you know, from the cold, and you have to turn have you ever tried and you turn your heater on and you try to drive with just a little bit and you're looking down there, you know, it's terrible. Don't do that spiritually. You can get away with that when you're driving, but just sit and wait till all of that clears out of the way. You probably should do that when you're driving too, right? Sit and wait till it all clears from your mind, till it's just you and God, and you say, okay, God, you alone. The next thing is be focused. Lord, I just want to behold you in your beauty. I just want to know you. All those problems I have, the loss I've experienced, all of that, it's real. But Lord, I want to set that aside. Lord, show me your beauty. Show me who you are. I want to know you. Confess who God is. Look at what he says about God. My rock, my salvation, my fortress, my hope, my rocks, my salvation, my fortress. Twice, you know, my mighty rock, my refuge. You know, start to confess who God is. God, this is who you are to me. 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 After you've been silent and you feel like you've confessed, you've gotten all the stuff out of the way, just start to confess who God is. This is who you are. And then start to confess your victory. Look, he says it twice. I will not be shaken. I will not be shaken. I will not be shaken. You see, until you confess who God is, you can't confess who you are. It won't work. But when you say, God, you're my rock, you're my fortress, you're my deliverer, you're my refuge, you're my protector, you're the one who's forgiven me, you start to do that for a while, and you're going to go, I shall not be shaken. I shall not be moved. I shall not be shaken. But if you aren't sure of who God is, how can you be sure of who you are? Doesn't work, right? Be sure of God. Confess your victory and then be hopeful. Look at what he says. For my hope is from him. You know, there's a song we used to do. My hope is in you, Lord. My life is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord, you know. Hope in God. God, I have hope. I have hope this is going to work out, God. I have hope. My hope is in you. There's some things that I've put my hope in for God. If I looked at the circumstance, I'd think, no way, this will never happen. But my hope is not in the circumstance, it's in God. It's in God. And then be at rest. Be at rest. Boy, isn't it nice to rest? You know, on God rests my deliverance. So I'm going to rest in him. And the final thing is proclaim in faith. You know, Chris, I'm going to make it. I spent time with God and I'm going to make it. I'm going to stand firm. That's what David does at the end. You know, hey, Chris, I understand what you're going through. I've been through it. Pour out your heart to him because God, listen to what he says. Trust in him all time, oh people. Pour out your hearts. God is a refuge. Wouldn't that be a great testimony because you went out into the desert and you met with God and you come out of the desert and you say, you meet someone who's struggling and say, listen, I've learned three things. Trust in him. Pour out your heart. He's a refuge. Wow. And the Holy Spirit, because you've lived it, will take that and minister it to the people that you care about. Does that make sense? A lot there in one verse, isn't there? Yeah. Well, if the worship team would please come and let me pray for us. Gracious Heavenly Father, we love you and we give you glory and honor and praise. And I pray for these dear people here that you have selected to hear this message on this day. So you want them to do something. And I pray, God, that they would be. Lord, there was a group of early Christians and they were called the Desert Fathers because they wanted to get out and know you. And I pray that these would be men and women and children of the desert, that when they suffer loss, when they're in the midst of mourning, they would go out into the desert and encounter you there and come out of the desert changed. We love you, Lord. We give you glory and honor and praise. Amen. Let's worship him.
Play this blessing together. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you. Amen. God bless you.